Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Ambassador Sherman, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to welcome you to Rice University's Baker Institute and to our colloquium on U.S.-Iran relations at a crossroads. Our event comes at a critical juncture, as it is nearly 9 months since the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action was signed in Vienna on July 14, 2015, and 3 months since implementation day occurred on January 16, 2016. Debates on the merits of the agreement reached between Iran and the P5+1 have been intense in Iran, just as much as here in the United States. As we move deeper into the presidential campaign, God help us. and closer to a new presidential administration, there could not be a better time to examine where we stand on one of President Obama's most significant policy initiatives, one that may constitute one of the defining legacies of his presidency, or, hopefully not, unravel in mutual recrimination and regret. We are joined today by a distinguished group of speakers who will examine different but interrelated aspects of the tangled U.S.-Iranian relationship. We are honored to be hosting Ambassador Wendy Sherman, who, as Undersecretary of State for Political Affairs, served as the lead negotiator for the United States in the many rounds of negotiations that culminated in the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. We look forward to hearing her perspective on the nuclear deal and prospects for U.S.-Iran relations. Wendy and I go back a long time, and I think her best training to deal with the Iranians in negotiations when she was Assistant Secretary of State for Legislative Affairs, and had to deal with Congress. I accompanied her many times up on a hill to deal on Middle East issues. We also welcome today three panels of experts who will address the internal dynamics that are shaping U.S.-Iranian relations, the impact of those relations on a regional landscape that is probably more volatile and unpredictable today than at any point in the past 40 years, certainly in my experience, and Iran's future role in international energy markets. I am delighted that our speakers will be able to give us a perspective of how the debate looks from Tehran, as well as from Washington, D.C. For all the debates between advocates and opponents of the nuclear deal here in the United States, it is important to note that similar debates are occurring between so-called moderates and hardliners in Iran as well. We begin with two panels organized by the Center for the Middle East at the Baker Institute. Our first panel takes a broad view and examines the strategic landscape that frames the evolution of U.S.-Iran relations. We have four speakers on the panel who will analyze the perspectives on the nuclear deal from Washington, Tehran, Russia, and the Gulf Arab states. For all the heat the debate has stirred in the United States and Iran, it is important to remember that the agreement was an international one that involved the permanent members of the United Nations Security Council and the European Union, and that it has regional implications for our longstanding political and security partners in the Middle East. Our second panel of three experts will examine whether and how the nuclear deal has changed or is likely to change the direction of internal developments and assess the implications of U.S.-Iran relations going forward. Our third panel, after Ambassador Sherman delivers the Shell Distinguished Lecture Series keynote luncheon address, has been organized by the Baker Institute Center for Energy Studies and will take an in-depth look at the impact of Iran's new and expanded role in global energy markets. Our colloquium today has been organized by two of the Baker Institute's most prominent centers, the Center for the Middle East and, as I mentioned, the Center for Energy Studies. Both our centers provide nonpartisan, high-quality analysis of key contemporary issues that often can be politically divisive. You can find a description of these centers in your program. So it is in this spirit that we have convened our colloquium today so that we may cut through the noise and the controversy to focus on the issues that matter to policymakers as we move into the implementation phase of the nuclear agreement. It will not be easy, to overcome the legacy of more than 36 years of mutual tension and recrimination since the troubled events of 1979. Domestic political opposition to the Iran deal, both in the United States and in Iran, may yet undermine the implementation process agreed last summer in Vienna. Many sanctions on Iran remain in place, including financial sanctions that bar American citizens and businesses from most forms of investment and trade with Iran, and which have worldwide implications for international companies seeking to do business with Iran. With this in mind, our colloquium provides an opportunity for Ambassador Sherman and our panels of speakers to shine a light on how we got to where we are today and the direction in which U.S.-Iran relations may be heading. So finally, this work is only possible with the participation of the supporters of the Baker Institute, including the members of our Baker Institute Roundtable, who help advance the mission through annual giving and direct engagement with our research programs. So those of you who are not members of the Baker Institute Roundtable, I urge you to take a look and join us in this work, and please talk to one of our fellows or staff or visit our website. So I would now like to invite the first panel to the podium and welcome Joe Bonds, the Bonner Means Baker Fellow at the Baker Institute, to moderate this panel. Thank you very much.
Gordon, please. Good morning. My name is Joe Barnes. I'm the Bonner Means Baker Fellow here at the Baker Institute. It's my pleasure and privilege this morning to moderate this panel on the strategic landscape in the wake of the nuclear deal. We have a number of very distinguished panelists with us today. Dr. Philip Gordon is a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations. F. Gregory Gause III is a PhD, and the John H. Lindsay, class of 1944, chair, professor and head, International Affairs Department, Bush School of Government and Public Service, Texas A&M University, our relatively close neighbor to the north. Dr. Mohsen Malani, executive director, Center for Strategic and Diplomatic Studies and professor, politics, University of South Florida. And Dr. John W. Parker, he's a visiting senior research fellow, Institute for National Strategic Studies, National Defense University. I just gave a very, very brief list of affiliations. For further information on our very distinguished panelists, I urge you to look at our program, which contains more comprehensive biographies of each of them. The way we plan to run the panel today, with the indulgence of the panelists, is to begin with a relatively brief 10 to 15 minute presentation by each of the panelists in the order in which they sit from me. So in other words, Gordon, Gause, et cetera, this way. Following that, I may ask a couple questions of the panelists. The panelists may ask questions of each other. And at the end of the period, we hope to be able to take some questions from the floor. And because I find those always very interesting and invariably a useful addition to our deliberations. Dr. Gordon.
Joe, thanks very much. Good morning, everybody. It's great to be here. The topic couldn't be more timely, and we have a great set of colleagues. I look forward to the discussions. This first panel that we're doing here is called The Strategic Landscape, which I took to mean what is going on in the region that is relevant to our core topic, which is U.S.-Iran relations and U.S. policy towards Iran. And obviously, there are a lot of things going on in this turbulent region right now. But let me start with what I think is most central as the background to U.S. policy towards Iran, and then say what I think that means for what U.S. policy towards Iran should be. And what I would focus on more than anything else, and I'm sure others will address this as well, is what is going on includes a very deep geopolitical and sectarian competition between Iran and Saudi Arabia and other majority Sunni states in the region. And I start with that because I think that's the central geopolitical factor that's going on that affects Iran policy and U.S.-Iran relations. It affects everything. It affects the oil question, which I know is a topic this afternoon, because it in part explains why the Saudis are determined to avoid driving the price up in a way that would benefit Iran and spur investment in Iran. It affects what's going on in Syria, because Iran is absolutely determined to continue to back the Assad regime to prevent Syria from falling into a Sunni orbit. And Saudi Arabia is equally determined to get rid of him to eliminate Iranian influence in Syria. And I think Saudi policy in Syria is driven more. It's not driven by some principled objection to Assad as a dictator. It's driven by a desire to reduce Iranian influence in Syria. This geopolitical competition is relevant in Yemen, where I think more than anything, the Saudi intervention can be explained as a desire to counter Iran rather than anything particularly internally unique to Yemen. It is relevant for the U.S.-Saudi and the U.S.-Gulf relationship, which has been under strain for a number of reasons. But first and foremost, the Saudi perception, rightly or wrongly, that the United States has not been vigorous enough and rigorous enough in containing Iran and defending what the Saudis consider to be their interests. And President Obama will be there soon, and this will no doubt be the top item on the agenda. So that's why, of all of the things I would pick in discussing the strategic landscape for U.S.-Iranian relations, that's what I would start with and focus on. Now, as for why this is such a big deal now, I mean, Saudi Arabia and Iran have both been around for a long time. Why is this so central now and so relevant to the Iran question? I would say a couple of things. Now, obviously, again, the Saudi-Iranian rivalry has ebbed and flowed over the years. I think gradually over the past decades it has grown, obviously after the 79 Iranian Revolution, even more after the 2003 invasion of Iraq, which tipped the sectarian balance in that country and made the Sunnis, led by the Saudis, even more concerned. But the latest wave, I think, stems from the Arab Spring and this series of developments that destroyed states and a number of states and institutions across the region starting in 2011. And the reason I say that has exacerbated it, again, something that has ebbed and flowed over the years, is more than anything two things. One is when security disappears, and security, even in the form of autocratic regimes keeping stability, I mean, that has its obvious downsides, but just in terms of people feeling that they're not going to be threatened with violence, when those institutions and leaders and autocrats disappear, people tend to turn to their kin as necessary. And so you see in a number of these countries where the sectarian balance, there was a lid on it simply because you had an autocrat and a dictator and security forces. Once that's gone, it's every person for themselves, and the tendency is turned more toward ethnic or religious kin. And you see that as Syria, Yemen, Libya, and other places fracture along these lines. And so that has exacerbated these tensions. And again, when we talk about the Saudi-Iran thing, we're talking about a geopolitical competition, we're talking about an Arab-Persian competition, and we're talking about a sectarian competition. It's sometimes hard to separate them, but I think no doubt this post-Arab Spring environment fuels at least the sectarian piece. It fuels all three pieces in terms of some of these countries being, so to speak, up for grabs, by which I mean when a long-standing dictatorship or state or institution is removed, it's an open question who's going to govern. Now, Saudi Arabia may not have been thrilled with an Iran-backed Alawite leadership in Syria for the previous number of decades, but that was what it was, and nobody was really thinking of changing it. When you get a revolution, instability, and a teetering government, it's actually an open question, who's going to run the show? Same is true in Iraq, same is true in Yemen, same is true across the region in a number of places. And so, again, post-Arab Spring, some of these countries are up for grabs, and when something is up for grabs, you have to go seize it, if for no other reason than your enemy might seize it. So I think those factors are all exacerbating this long-standing dynamic. And then the last thing I would mention in this regard, and I'll come back to it, and others will as well, is the Iran nuclear deal, which, again, whatever your view on it is true that it is part of this landscape, at least from a Saudi and Gulf perspective, in that it does free up Iranian assets, which from a Saudi point of view they can use for nefarious destabilizing activity. It allows Iran to start selling oil and reap the benefits from doing that. And I think this is what I would stress, because it's relevant for U.S. policy, in Saudi eyes, it opens up at least the possibility of a different American relationship towards Iran and policy towards Iran. And I would really stress that, because that's the Saudi nightmare. I mean, I would say they don't love the nuclear deal in and of itself, even though they went along with it. And obviously, they don't want to see Iran get a nuclear weapon, so they welcome that aspect of it. But the real thing that troubled the Saudis in the nuclear deal, Wendy Sherman may address this, but I suspect she would agree with what I'm about to say, was the fear that this would lead to a U.S. rapprochement and different relationship with Iran. And even as we consistently said that it's not about that, it's about stopping them from getting nuclear weapons, the Saudis feared otherwise and continue to fear otherwise. And in contrast to others in the region, like the Israelis, who wanted to understand every technical potential nuclear-related detail, the Saudis were less interested in that. What they wanted to know was, what's your overall Iran policy? And is this really going to lead to a rapprochement and a pivot? So all of that, I think, describes what I would consider the main elements of the landscape for U.S.-Iran policy. And I've focused on the Saudis, but of course it's not just them. The Israelis have the same concern about a new U.S. policy towards Iran. The United Arab Emirates, you may have seen Ambassador Taiba's piece in the Wall Street Journal just a week or two ago saying, you know, Iran hasn't changed. Turkey, other countries in the region. So that's the landscape, and obviously that's a short version of a lot of complicated things going on. What does that mean for U.S. policy? And I'll just be brief on here with three points, because again, I know we'll come back to all of these in the discussion. I would summarize it as saying the United States in that context should do what it is doing to take the nuclear question off the table, continue to contain Iran and stand by its traditional allies in the region, and I think this is important, explore at least the potential for a different and long-term relationship with Iran. On the nuclear deal, I would just briefly say, because I could imagine some might say, well, if you argued that the nuclear deal is contributing to this tension and competition, mm-hmm. then why support it? And I think the simple answer there is Iran was on the verge of a nuclear weapons capability. Iran with a nuclear weapon would have all sorts of negative consequences, including for the competitions that I just described, including for proliferation in the region. And so it was critical to negotiate a deal that would take that off the table for a considerable amount of time. We can debate, and fortunately I don't think we have to do it here, as many of us have done for the last couple of years, the merits of a deal and whether there was a better deal available. But my own view is that the absence of a deal similar to this one was not a much better deal that didn't free up Iranian assets, that was never on the table, but in Iran that would continue to creep towards a nuclear weapons capability or even development. And so now with this deal, if it's implemented, and we can come back to that too, we don't have to worry about that particular issue for a good 10 or 15 years. Secondly, I think the United States in this complicated, dangerous context needs to continue its policy of containing Iran in the region. And I would underscore that it is doing so. There is a perception out there, and I referred to it in the Saudi eyes, that the Iran nuclear deal has signaled a pivot, and the United States is now somehow equidistant between Iran and its partners in the Gulf. But if you take a step back and think about it, it's not, and it's not even close. Okay, so now there are not secondary sanctions or UN security sanctions on Iran. But the United States doesn't trade with Iran, it doesn't invest in Iran, it has all sorts of designations on Iranian entities. It has, in contrast, deep relations with all of its Gulf partners. It continues to sell them large amounts of weapons, intelligence cooperation, military cooperation, backing for their efforts in Syria and Yemen. So I would say, I would just remind people, I think it's just a deep misperception, the idea that the United States has somehow tilted or given up on the containment policy of Iran, for which there is good reason. And then lastly, and I'll end with this because I want to keep to the time and have plenty of time for discussion. While doing that, I think it is right for the United States to explore whether over the longer term, the course of this nuclear deal that I described, a different relationship with Iran is possible, because it is in our interest, and I don't think we have to apologize for that. It's not happening now, and it's not likely in the short term, but let me again stress, I don't know anyone in the administration or out who believed that within 6 months of implementation day, Iran would be an open, democratic friend of the United States in the region. That was not going to happen and hasn't happened. But it's at least worth imagining that over the course of time, Iran could change. And I think there are actually some reasons to believe that that's possible. In my view, at least, and there's a panel on the internal developments, and I'll be interested what the experts have to say, but when you look back over the past 20 years, it seems to me, every time Iran has had a chance, even through flawed and limited elections, to express itself, the Iranian public, they have expressed themselves as wanting change, openness, integration in the international community. We're going back to Khatami, Mousavi, the most recent election, Rouhani, 2016. I think what they're saying is, or what we can deduced from that, and anecdotal and other polling evidence supports it, is the Iranian people do want change. There's a reason to believe with a more open Iranian economy, which will create a middle class that also wants change, openness, rule of law, democracy, that they will move in that direction. And there's a chance that if we can minimize the threat perception that Iranians, and not just the regime, feel towards the United States, for understandable reasons, and we don't have to take the Iranian view of the world to understand why they might fear and worry about the threat from their neighbors in the United States, which after all has changed the regime to their east and to their west. If over the course of the next generation that can be reduced, maybe there would be a chance for a different relationship with Iran. It's not guaranteed, and if Iran in 15 years is a state supporter of terror and intervening in its neighbors and non-democratic, then the president of the United States and other leaders in the region will have to decide how to deal with that Iran. But that would be, I think, an unfortunate situation for everyone, and one that is in our interest to avoid. And so it seems to me to make sense in the meantime, and we bought ourselves some time, to at least explore whether a different relationship is possible.
Thank you. Dr. Gauz.
Thanks. Howdy. No Aggies here? Gig'em. That's the way we start talks in College Station. We say howdy. I know you sophisticates down here in Houston probably don't do things like that. But it's great to be at Rice. I'm not going to say things much different than Phil did. I think we have a common understanding of the strategic situation, but I will give different emphases, and I want to pitch this as two misunderstandings and one possible game changer. So the first misunderstanding: when Phil started his talk, he started with sectarianism, and he then went to the collapse of states. I do it the opposite. I think that the real root cause of the current crisis in the region, not just the Persian Gulf, but in the region as a whole, is the collapse, the weakening and collapse of state authority in the Arab world. Sectarianism, I think, is not a top-down phenomenon. I don't think the Saudis and the Iranians impose sectarianism on the region. I think sectarianism is a bottom-up phenomenon, as Phil said. Right? When order collapses, people rush to their corners. People rush to the communities where they feel safe, where they feel they will not be killed, where they feel that they will be provided with the basic requisites of life. When the state, even a terrible autocratic state, right, is no longer able to provide order, people will seek that protection in smaller communities. Now, in many parts of the Eastern Arab world, for historical reasons that if I had 15 minutes instead of 10, I could explain to you, but I can't in 10 minutes. I want to keep it within 10. So I can't explain the historical origins of this, okay? But in many parts of the Eastern Arab world, when authority collapses, the communities people run to are sectarian. Now, this is not exclusive. We hear a lot about the role that the Kurds are playing in Iraq and Syria, maybe in Turkey and Iran, the Kurds are not a sectarian group. They're an ethno-linguistic national group that contains both Sunnis and Shia. Right? If we look outside the Eastern Arab world to Libya, where the state has collapsed, right, we see as brutal a civil war going on, but not on a sectarian basis, rather on a regional, on a tribal, on an ideological basis. Right? In a place like Yemen, where we have a sectarian overlay placed upon the conflict, largely because of outside intervention, but also because of it just fits into our model of understanding what's going on in the Middle East. Right? Zaydi Shia and Shafi'i Sunnis have been getting along for quite a while, centuries. And the Zaydis and the Shafi'is, right, have not always been the axes of conflict in Yemen. And if we look at Yemen today, I would say that it would be a mistake to see this as a sectarian conflict. Right? The Houthis are part of the Zaydi community, but Abdurrabbu Mansur Hadi, the quote-unquote president of Yemen, right, just appointed a vice president, Ali Mohsen al-Ahmar, who is a Zaydi Shia. Things are a lot more complicated. And I think it's a mistake for us to start with sectarianism. Because if we start with sectarianism, we don't go beyond it into the details. Even the president of the United States, who I think is a really smart guy. And I would give a solid B to his Middle East policy. Before Phil came on the National Security Council, it was going to be a C. But when Phil came on, I raised it to a B. I gave him a solid B in foreign policy in the Middle East. Even he says, oh, these Sunnis and Shia have been fighting each other forever, right? I think we have to get beyond that. So the first big misunderstanding is that this is a Sunni-Shia fight. This is a fight about the direction, as Phil said, about the direction of politics in places where the state has collapsed. And now this is up for grabs, right? This is up for grabs. I think it's extremely similar to Arab politics in the 50s and 60s, right? A time characterized as the Arab Cold War by one of America's leading scholars of the politics of the Middle East at that time, Malcolm Kerr, who is now better known as the father of Steve Kerr, the coach of the Golden State Warriors, right? But Malcolm Kerr, assassinated in 1984 in Lebanon when he was president of the American University of Beirut, was one of our leading scholars of the region. His book, The Arab Cold War, is as relevant today as it was then. Then it was Arab nationalism, fighting against the quote-unquote reactionaries, but not fighting wars, right? Not fighting conventional wars. When the Egyptians fought a conventional war against Israel, they brought it on themselves in 67. That was the end of Nasser's appeal. Nasser's appeal was all about his ability to mobilize clients and allies and followers in other Arab states to follow his lead. And then the ability of people who didn't like Nasser, like the Saudis, to try to mobilize their clients and allies and supporters. And the future of the region was fought out in the domestic politics of these states. And that's what's happening now. Right? Sectarianism is bottom up. Shia naturally look to Iran. Sunnis naturally look to Saudi Arabia. But I would contend that the Iranians and the Saudis are playing a pure balance of power game. If the Iranians can find allies in the Sunni community, they do. Hamas, although the relationship has been strained by recent events. Right? The Saudis backed Iyad Alawi, who was the head of the Iraqi party in Iraq, in the national elections in Iraq in 05 and 10, right? Iyad Alawi is a Shi'i. Now, he's not a religious man, and he put together an interesting cross-sectarian and multi-ethnic political party to try to contest for power in Iraq. The Saudis backed him, right, with lots of money. They lost. Saudis have mostly lost in this contest with Iran. Right. And I think that if you lined up 100 members of the Shia ulama, right, the men of religion, the Ayatollahs, the Hujjatul Islams, and you asked them if Alawis were Shia, 90 of them would say no. right? The relationship between the Assad regime in Damascus and the Islamic Republic of Iran, I don't think has anything to do with the fact that the Alawis are a heterodox offshoot of Shiism. I think it has everything to do with balance of power politics. Nature abhors a vacuum, and in the political world, political vacuums draw in regional powers. As Phil said, not just Iran and Saudi Arabia, God help us, the Qataris, the Emiratis, the Turks, the Israelis, not so much. The Israelis tried to play this game in Lebanon in the 1980s and got very badly burned, right? They got very badly burned, right, by attempting to readjust and realign the domestic politics of an Arab state. And so they're not as active, but all sorts of folks are in there besides the Russians and us. So that's the first misunderstanding. I don't think it's right to think of this as a sectarian fight from an international politics perspective. It's a sectarian fight in Iraq and in Lebanon and in Syria. People are getting killed because of their sectarian identity. I don't want to minimize that. But in trying to understand the international politics of this, this is a fight about the direction of the region that's been caused by the collapse of authority in so many places across the region and the creation of political vacuums. Second misunderstanding, right? The president is going to go and attend a Gulf Cooperation Council summit. And there are going to be Gulf Cooperation Council statements. There are going to be Gulf Cooperation Council declarations about how awful Iran is and all of this kinds of thing. It would be easy for us to think that all of the states on the Arab side of the Persian Gulf have the same policy toward Iran. They don't, right? Saudi Arabia is taking a very unnatural position for itself historically in taking the lead in trying to counter what they see as the spread of Iranian influence in the region. I can put on my Saudi hat during questions and do an even better job than Phil in talking about how they feel that the Iranians are surrounding them and mistreating them and are hegemonic. But if you look at the smaller states, they have very different approaches to Iran. And I think you have to understand that if you're going to understand the dynamics of the states themselves. The Emiratis and the Bahrainis have affixed themselves to the Saudis on this issue for different reasons. The Bahrainis, because they're worried about their domestic stability, a Sunni monarchy and a Shia majority country that had a regime-shaking crisis in 2011. The Emiratis have a long-standing grudge with the Iranians over the islands issue, something that dates back to the time of the Shah. And the Emiratis are trying to put themselves forward as a bigger player in regional politics. But look at the Kuwaitis. Kuwait has a substantial Shia minority, right, in its population that is extremely well integrated into local politics. And because of all sorts of things that I'd love to talk about, because I love Kuwaiti politics, but I can tell that you probably aren't really that interested in who and how the dynamics in District 1 of Kuwaiti parliamentary elections work. The Shia community in Kuwait is actually more royalist than the king these days. They're incredibly strong supporters of the government, okay? The Qataris and the Omanis have business-like relations with Tehran because they do business with Tehran. The Omanis, since the revolution, have shared the management of the Strait of Hormuz with Tehran. They have always had a business-like relationship. They are the ones, of course, who hosted the talks between the Iranian regime and then the Rouhani administration and the Obama administration. I think Secretary Sherman enjoyed the hospitality of Muscat once or twice on that. And the Qataris share the North Dome gas field with the Iranians. That's what makes Qatar the richest country in the world by per capita income. And so they have a business-like relationship. It's a mistake for us to think of all of the Arab side of the Gulf as having one policy toward Iran. It's not true. Finally, the one possible game changer. It's hard to argue that the collapse of oil prices, especially when you're in Houston, it's hard to argue that the collapse of oil prices has any silver lining to it. But hello, you guys, is this working? Houston, energy, little drop of oil price. Okay, all right, fine. All the energy people are at work. Let's just have the academics here. There we go. All right. So I would actually argue that the collapse of oil prices has a silver lining in terms of regional politics. And that silver lining is that it's really expensive to have a forward foreign policy. It's really expensive to maintain your clients. It's really expensive to run interventions in Yemen. It's really expensive to prop up a regime in Damascus that's holding on by its fingernails, right? All of the states of the region are facing straitened circumstances. And the Iranians, just in today's New York Times, they're going to cancel the $12 a month giveaway, right? That they put in after the subsidies got reduced. The Saudis, they're not poor, but they are running deficits that cannot be sustained over a 5 or 6 year period. I think that it's possible by the end of this year that both Tehran and Riyadh will see the necessity of actually sitting down and talking about oil prices. I think the Saudis are already there. They're talking to the Russians about freezes. Right, they're talking to there was a Houthi delegation in Riyadh last week. I think the Iranians are probably still feeling their oats a little bit after the sanctions removal, but I think they're going to find out pretty quick that they're not going to get rich because they're back in the market. And I think that there will come a point where the Iranians will say, you know, we got to sit down with the damn Saudis. This has happened before. Right, this happened before OPEC, NOPEC production agreements to try to put a floor under prices just as recently as the late 1990s. There was in the late 1990s, but just as recently as the late 2000s during the financial crisis. Right, there were agreements on production limitations. The Saudis have made it clear they're not going to take disproportionate cuts, but if everybody else will cut, the Saudis will cut. And that's the quickest way to push oil prices up. And so I see the possibility that by the end of this year, the Saudis and the Iranians will actually be talking about this. Now, whether talking about that will then spill over into talking about regional crises in Yemen and Syria and other places, I don't want to say that's a sure thing, but it becomes more likely if the Saudis and the Iranians, along with other players, including the Russians, are talking about deals to limit oil production to try to push prices up. It becomes more likely that at least the atmosphere improves enough for some possible diplomatic initiatives. Thank you.
Dr. Malani.
Good morning. Thank you very much. For inviting me, it is a great honor to come to the James Baker Institute for Public Policy. My only complaint is that since I got here about 28 hours ago, I have not seen the sun. I come from Florida, and I'm used to seeing the sun, so I don't have as much energy as I usually do. And moreover, they say that an average audience can pay attention to the speakers for no more than 20 to 30 minutes. That means you didn't understand anything Greg was saying in the last 10 minutes of his talk.
Probably just as well.
That's right. And you will have absolutely no idea what I am going to talk about. Having said that, I've decided to summarize my question and my answers in about 2 minutes. And after that 2 minutes, please consult with your cell phone, Google things, and don't pay any attention. So here is the question. Has Iran's regional standing improved 1 year after the landmark nuclear deal, which was struck between Iran and six global powers and was approved by the UN Security Council? Some opponents of the deal, particularly Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates, maintain that the nuclear deal has enriched Iran financially and has rendered it more aggressive, more ambitious, and more hegemonic. While the UAE ambassador to the United States laments that, quote, Iran is today as dangerous as ever, the Saudi foreign minister warns us that, quote, Iran is the new great power of the Middle East, and the U.S. is the old. Their assumption, however, are rooted in a flawed understanding of the nuclear deal and the causes of the lingering turmoil in the Middle East. And most importantly, the Saudis and the Emiratis are oblivious to the consequences of their own misguided regional policies, and they give the impression that their hands are totally clean and they are on the right side of history. They are wrong. The contention of my paper is that the nuclear deal has in fact significantly reduced regional tensions. It has made it safer for all the parties, including the Saudis and Emiratis, and it has seriously reduced the prospects of proliferations of weapons of mass destruction in that important region. Moreover, the nuclear deal, which was an exclusively an arms control agreement and had zero to do, had nothing to do with Iran's regional behavior or Iranian foreign policy, has resulted in no fundamental change in the orientation of Iranian regional policy. However, there are some evidence suggesting that Iran has moderated some aspects of its regional policy. Such modest moderation, however, is unsustainable unless Iran's main rival, Saudi Arabia, is prepared to moderate its foreign policy toward Iran and stop its hostility toward Iran by becoming the new leader of an anti-Iran coalition. Without the nuclear deal, we would have absolutely no prospects for improving relations between Iran and the United States, the two countries that I love. But with this nuclear deal, there is now more chances of improved relations between these two countries. And here lies the main reason why the Saudis and the Emiratis and others are so afraid of what has taken place. They do not want to see a detente between the U.S. and Iran, because they know better than anyone else that should there be such a detente, their strategic significance will diminish significantly. Now go ahead and enjoy the rest of the talk. Let me explain now why I have reached that conclusion. First, the problem, as I said, with the way the Saudis and other opponents of the nuclear deal has dealt with this issue is that they misunderstand what took place. We have somebody here who has been involved in the negotiations, and maybe during lunch he can correct me. These negotiations were about one thing, not two, not three, not four, one thing, to stop Iran from becoming a nuclear power, period, end of the story. And I believe it has achieved its goal. Now, whether Iran is going to change its regional policy, that is something that we can hope for. So when the Saudis say the nuclear deal has resulted in Iran becoming more powerful force, I think they misunderstand the nature of what has taken place. Moreover, they often blame Iran as if Iran is the cause of the turmoil. I think you have explained in full detail that what is taking place in the Middle East today has nothing to do with Iranian policy. It's the breakdown of the order that was established after World War I. That order is breaking down, and Iran has taken great advantage of this. Now, the key point for all of this, the key point is that Iran and Saudi Arabia are involved in what I call a Cold War. Iran and Saudi Arabia have never been good friends. Even during the Shah's days, when Iran was the policeman of the Persian Gulf, when President Nixon was pursuing the so-called two-pillar policies, and both the Saudis and the Iranians were under the strategic security umbrella of the United States, the Saudis resented the fact that Iran had the upper hand in the Persian Gulf. But right now, there are people who keep proposing, who keeps saying that the cause of the turmoil today in the Middle East is sectarianism, and then they blame Iran for pushing the Shiites, and some of them sometimes blame the Saudis for pushing sectarianism. That is a flawed, dangerous, simplistic view of what is taking place. What is taking place in Iran, and it is started immediately after the British withdrew from the Persian Gulf, is a struggle between Iran and Saudi Arabia for the hegemony of the Persian Gulf. It is a game about power, who has it and who controls that oil in that region. Now, both countries, both Iran and Saudi Arabia, have used sectarianism to push their agenda. But sectarianism is not the cause of this. Sectarianism is one of the tools that the both countries have used to enhance their agenda. In this Cold War between Iran and the Saudis, there are three battlegrounds. Number one is Iraq. Iraq, in my judgment, is the most important battleground for the Cold War between Iran and Saudi Arabia. More important even than Syria, and I'll explain why. Saddam Hussein was the most effective bastion against Persian influence in the Arab world and the Levant. This is why when the war between Iraq and Iran started on September of 1980, the Saudis, with the help of the Kuwaitis, lubricated Saddam Hussein's war machine to the tune of $55 billion. That is dollars in the 1980s, which is something like about $120, $130 billion today. Why did they do this? Well, they really wanted to stop Iran. They were afraid of the idea of the export of revolution, but they always looked at Iraq as the place that Iranian expansions into the Levant and the Arab world can be stopped. Now, once the Americans decided to go to Iraq and overthrow Saddam Hussein, this is when the Cold War between Iran and Saudi Arabia intensified. Why? Because not only Saddam's regime, which was the bastion against Persian influence, was overthrown, something else happened that has not happened in that region for at least 400 years. For the first time, you had a friendly government, a Shia-dominated friendly government in Baghdad. No country in the modern history of Iran, and when I say modern, I don't mean 20 years, I mean 500 years. In the modern history of Iran, no country has inflicted more damage, more death and destruction on Iran than Iraq did. And when Saddam Hussein was removed, thanks to the American military force, once he was removed from there, the single greatest threat to Iran was also removed, and that angered the Saudis. Not only Saddam was removed, we had a friendly government in Tehran-friendly government in Iraq, and that even pissed them off more. So what did they do? Well, they opposed the occupation, and we do know that a good number of Saudis, not supported by their government, but Saudi citizens also joined the anti-coalition forces in Iraq. And also, we know that now, when ISIS has become a powerful force in Iraq, the Saudis are pursuing an ambivalent stand toward ISIS. On the one hand, they see some benefit in ISIS. ISIS is anti-Iran, ISIS is anti-Shiite, and ISIS is anti-Baghdad government that is friendly toward Iran. The danger for ISIS, the danger for the Saudis, is that these crazy guys want to expand the caliphate. And that means that they might want to go to Mecca too. So that is why they have this ambivalent. But as long
there's no might about it.
I try to be, when I talk about ISIS, I try to be very conservative because it's impossible to predict what they do. So in Iraq, they think they lost. And to be frank with you, if I would have been a Saudi, I would have reached the same conclusion. So how do you deal with this? Well, you deal with it in Syria. Now, Saudi Arabia opposed every single movement of the Arab Spring. There is not one movement in the Arab Spring that they supported, except when it happened in Syria. And Iran did not oppose a single Arab Spring movement until when it came to Syria. So they both were the opposite sides. So what do the Saudis want? The Saudis want to A, get rid of Assad, because Assad has formed the oldest strategic alliance with Iran of any Arab country in the past 100 years. Number two, Iran is using Syria to support Hezbollah in Lebanon, which is the most valuable, most important strategic asset Iran has anywhere in the world. And finally, the Saudis are trying to stop what they think is Iranian intervention in the Arab world. They think that if they can undermine Iran in Saudi Arabia, that entire axis of resistance that runs from Iran all the way to Iraq, to Syria, and then to Lebanon can be undermined. And frankly, if they can achieve their goal, that axis of resistance could be undermined. Iran has invested heavily in Syria, and they are not likely to give it up easily. But the Cold War now is focusing on Syria because the Saudis are convinced if they can defeat Iran there, if they can defeat Assad there, then they are going to have a much easier time to undermine Iran in Lebanon, and definitely much easier time to undermine Iran in Iraq. And that takes me to the last part of this battleground, and that's the conflict in Yemen. The conflict in Yemen has nothing to do with the support the Iranians have provided to the Houthis. Have they supported the Houthis? Yes, they have. But has that support been critical? No, it has not been critical. They have provided some weapons. They have provided quite a bit of ideological support. And they are intervening in Yemen. But Iran does not have any national interest in Yemen. Iran does not have, the Islamic Republic does not have any vital national interest in Yemen. But the Saudis, by exaggerating the role of Iran, is providing Iran now with the opportunity to become a player there. The Saudis are spending $200 million a day. $200 million a day. These are not my number. They come from the New York Times. Of course, some people here would immediately say that discredited your whole argument. But it comes from the New York Times. They're spending $200 million a day. More than 5,000 to 6,000 people, many of them civilians, have been killed. Somewhere between 700,000 to 900,000 people have been displaced. Hundreds of buildings and hospitals and schools have been destroyed. And guess what? The Saudis have not achieved a single one of their goals. The Houthis are still there, and they will be there. And what they have done by exaggerating the role of Iran, now, once we have the peace treaty, and once there is a stability in Yemen, that means that Iran is going to become a player in Yemen. It wasn't a major player before, but thanks to the Saudis' ill-advised policy, they have made Iran now a player in Yemen. Now, what does it all mean for the U.S.? Well, here is where I think I'm going to make some of you very angry, but that's okay. For 37 years now, the U.S. has sided with Saudi Arabia on just about every conflict the Saudis have had with Iran. The Saudis have had carte blanche to do what they want in the region. Why? Because of fear of Iran. That policy, in my judgment, has to change. And if what I have read in The Atlantic, in the latest interview by President Obama with Mr. Goldberg, if that article is accurate, I believe President Obama has the wisdom, or has had the wisdom, to see exactly what has to change. When he talks about the end of free riders must come to an end, When he calls on the Saudis to have cold peace with Iran rather than cold war, I think he understands the dynamic. And he understands what we have to do for the next 1 to 10 years. The nuclear deal, in my judgment, has done something that is unique in the history of the Islamic Republic of Iran. And people do not pay enough attention to that fact. For the first time in the history of the Islamic Republic of Iran, there is now a constituency within the governing elite that is openly and publicly calling for better relations with the United States. We always had that faction, but it was latent. They weren't able to make it public. The fact that they have made it public means two things. A, it means that they have concluded there is substantial public support for it, and I believe they are right. And B, they think the balance of power is changing in their favor. So what does that mean? If America acts with perspicacity and wisdom and can think of 10 years ahead of time, not one or two, but 10 years, that change in Iranian society will provide the U.S. to come out with a new approach toward the Persian Gulf. The pivot toward Asia will happen whether President Obama is there or not. The pivot to Asia will happen because that's where the future is. That's where the money is. That's where the energy is. That's where I think the U.S. should move to, which means that the United States must have less engagement in the Middle East. We spent over $4 trillion in Afghanistan and Iraq, and what did we get out of it? It is time for the U.S. to go a little bit lower, and the only way the U.S. can do that is to have a rapprochement with Iran and push the Saudis and the Iranians to end their hostility. Some of you, and that's the last thing I'm going to say, some of you might conclude that I have been saying that Iranian hands have been cleaned in the Middle East. Believe me, I know better than most of you that the Iranian hands in the Middle East have not been clean. It has been pretty dirty. But my point is that let's be fair. Let's look at the other side and come out with a balance, a thoughtful strategy where we say to the Saudis and to the Iranians that these are our national interests. These are the national interests of the United States. And if you can side with me, good. But if you cannot side with me, adios. Thank you very much.
Dr. Parker?
Well, thanks, Joe, and thanks very much for the invitation to all of us to participate in this panel. I'd like to join with Greg with a loud howdy, but since I'm from Washington, I have to immediately follow that up with a disclaimer. that all of my comments, including howdy, represent my own personal views and are not intended to represent the policies or positions of the National Defense University, the Department of Defense, or the U.S. government. Glad I got that out of the way. So the question that I would like to focus on this morning with you is, are Russia and Iran strategic partners, or are they strategic competitors? Over the years, there have been those in Moscow, as well as in Tehran, who have advocated a strategic partnership between the two countries. Moscow has teased Tehran from time to time by holding out such a prospect, but has never committed to it. President Putin has stayed entirely away from strategic partnership language in regards to Iran. His restraint on the phrase has been consistent over the years, and in my view, he is unlikely ever to embrace it. To be sure, Moscow in recent years has gained appreciation for Iran as a barrier to Sunni extremism. But Putin is determined not to let Iran become an obstacle to Russia's own relations across the Middle East, even with Iranian archenemies Saudi Arabia and Israel. This dynamic has also been in play in recent years in Syria. During Putin's first term as president from 2000 to 2004, as part of his freshman round of Russian post-Soviet re-engagement in the Middle East, Moscow again began to treat Syria as an important player in the region. One aim, I think, was to wean Assad away from what Moscow then saw as a rising and more threatening Iran. Bashar al-Assad, however, who succeeded his father Hafez in July 2000, did not appear much interested in boosting ties with Moscow for many years until he needed Russian help in 2011 when the Syrian civil war began. However, the launch of Russia's air campaign over Syria last September reinforced assertions that Moscow was now firmly part of an Iranian-led Shia axis of resistance, fighting the various Sunni oppositions in Syria and their regional Sunni backers. Nevertheless, Moscow, Putin, has displayed agile cross-sectarian diplomatic footwork, both before and after its air campaign. While indeed working with Iran militarily in Syria, Russia has successfully pursued engagement with most major Sunni powers in the Middle East, most interestingly Saudi Arabia, as well as with Israel. At the same time, Russia has cooperated in the P5 plus one to clinch the nuclear deal last July with Iran, despite opposition to such an agreement from Saudi Arabia and Israel. Russia's aspirations in Syria overlap in part with those of Iran, but are independent. Russia and Iran are coordinating militarily in Syria, but ultimately may have divergent political outcomes and fates for Assad in mind. In the long run, Russia and Iran will be competitors for leverage on and favors from whatever regime remains in Damascus and or the Assad family stronghold of Latakia. While the jury is still out, it would appear at this juncture that the success of Russia's air campaign has secured Russia increased presence in Syria, in part, I would argue, at Iran's expense. Russia has also perhaps marginally increased its ability to manage Bashar al-Assad, though this is still a huge question mark and probably highly unlikely. In any event, Russia has acquired the Khmeimim air base outside Latakia, and Russia's formidable S-400 long-range air defense systems now give Moscow extensive dominance of the airspace in the region. So where does this leave the Iran-Russia-U.S. triangle? Iran, in my view, will want to keep both Russia and the United States, as well as Europe and China, engaged in competing with each other for its favor, rather than giving preference to one or the other. In some areas, Russia and Iran indeed will draw closer together in coming years. The lifting of nuclear sanctions, for example, opens the way for prospects of Iran finally becoming a full member of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. But in other areas, including some regional issues of utmost sensitivity to Iran, the countries will continue to go their separate ways. On business in the post-nuclear deal environment, Russia does have some advantages. However, so far there has been a lot of talk but few deals between Russia and Iran. Before the nuclear deal was clinched last July, the Russian government supported Russian business involvement in Iran while the nuclear negotiations were ongoing. But Russian companies did not like the risks of running afoul of Western sanctions on Iran, of American, especially, sanctions on Iran. Now, Russia itself is under sanctions for its 2014 military incursions into Crimea and then southeastern Ukraine. As a result, in part of those sanctions, but much more of Russia's unreformed economy and of the dramatic drop in the price of oil, the Russian economy is stagnating. Russian banks and government agencies are unable to obtain credits abroad for themselves, and so are in too poor a shape to extend substantial credits to Iran to stimulate bilateral trade and investment. So the outlook for a dramatic rise in the volume of trade between Russia and Iran is not promising. In general, a lot of people miss this, economic ties between Russia and Iran remain anemic, despite what seems to be continuous consultations on mega deals. Bilateral trade, for example, shrank to $1.3 billion last year from $1.7 billion in 2014. Russia has ambitions of raising this trade to $10 billion, but Iran's trade with China already far outstrips it at around $50 billion. Russia and Iran have agreed upon a portfolio of potential contracts adding up to $70 billion, but most of these remain paper aspirations only. Nevertheless, Iran is likely to return to the Russian arms market, although not exclusively to Russia. Deals under consideration could be worth as much as $8 billion. There is a lot Iran would like, according to Russia's chief arms merchant, Sergei Chemezov. However, so far, there are no concrete deals beyond the S-300. When it comes to weaponry, insists Chemezov, the Iranians must buy weapons with their own money, not with ours. Russia is not giving it away. However, as I mentioned, one notable major weapons contract has been renegotiated. A new $1 billion contract for four S-300 long-range air defense battalions was signed last November 9th. Half of these are already reportedly in Iran, and delivery of the rest of the systems could be completed by the end of this year. In other sectors, a $20 billion oil for goods exchange was being widely discussed well over a year ago, as well as an $8 to $10 billion electrical energy deal. However, technical and financial barriers have stood in the way of both. Russian Energy Minister Alexander Novak emphasizes that ramping up trade will depend most of all on lifting financial sanctions so that Iran can pay Russia with money and not goods. Russia wants cash. At the same time, Russia and Iran will be competitors for European gas and world oil markets. To the extent that Iranian gas can increasingly find its way to Europe, the competition between Russian and Iranian suppliers will advance the U.S. and EU goals of lessening Europe's dependence on Russian gas. Oil, I think, is different. Iran's return to world oil markets contributes to the glut Saudi Arabia has created, and you'll hear more about that later today. To the extent that Iran's increased production now, post-sanctions, helps prolong this glut, it's good, I think, for U.S. car drivers. We all pay less for gas, but it's bad for the profits of U.S. oil majors. And it's also bad news, I think, for the further development of American energy independence. On February 16th of this year, Russia, Saudi Arabia, Venezuela, and Qatar announced a tentative agreement to keep oil production at January levels if the rest of OPEC supports the move. We'll see what happens next at the meeting in Doha scheduled for this Sunday. Nevertheless, this production freeze initiative is an interesting comment on the so-called Shiite axis that Russia is allegedly a member of. Since Iran and Iraq may not support Russia in this effort to nudge oil prices higher, while the Sunni Saudis, arch enemies of Iran, are playing ball with Putin. Whatever the state of Russia-Iran ties, there will continue to be numerous irritants in U.S.-Iran relations. There will be no mechanical zero-sum dynamic. Iranian human rights violations that trouble American public opinion will continue.
Iran's Islamic Revolutionary Guards Corps is still running the show on troublesome missile tests and much of the action in Syria and Iraq. Supreme Leader Khamenei remains a tough conservative, deeply distrustful of the United States, and is trying to shape his own succession. In both Iran and the U.S., the nuclear deal remains politically contentious. On some regional security issues, however, there could be some potentially favorable outcomes for American allies in the Middle East that result from the evolving relationships between the U.S., Iran, and Russia. Over the years, for example, Israel has lobbied in Moscow on specific Iranian and Syrian-connected security issues. The two countries have built a good relationship in this regard. Putin's agreement with Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu about cooperation at the general staff level to deconflict operations in the airspace over Syria, I think, must irritate Tehran. To the extent that Russia has indeed been competing with and displacing Iran and Syria, Russia in the future may be able marginally to improve security for Israel by lessening threats to Israel emanating from the Golan Heights and by partially disrupting the air bridge Iran uses to supply Hezbollah in Lebanon, though the latter would be a real stretch. In conclusion, however, we need to remember that Moscow's default setting for dealing with Tehran over the years has been wary engagement, and vice versa for Tehran's approach to Moscow. Both sides are used to and adept at mixing cooperation and contention on different issues at the same time. And we can expect this pattern, I think, of wary engagement to continue for years to come. Thanks.
Now, I'll be using my prerogative to ask a couple questions before we move on. Dr. Milani, you mentioned that that Iran considers its influence with Hezbollah to be one of its vital national interests. Could you please explain why that's the case? And I'd like to ask about this because, and here Dr. Gordon perhaps can say something as well, which is that Iran's support for Hezbollah is surely going to be one of the major impediments to any sort of detente between Tehran and Washington.
If I knew you were going to ask that question, I would not have made that assertion. You invite me to come here to talk about Iran's standing in the region, and then you ask the most sensitive question, and I can see the cameras there. And on a serious note, the relationship between Iran and Hezbollah was established immediately with the organization that eventually became Hezbollah. It started immediately after the Islamic Revolution of 1979. Even prior to that, there were Ayatollah Khomeini was in contact with young Hassan Nasrallah. And as a matter of fact, he had given him an official recommendation to collect religious taxes on his behalf in Lebanon. But then once the revolution came, there was a small group of Iranian activists called the Syria Gang, or the Syria Mafia, as they used to be called, who convinced Ayatollah Khomeini that we need to do something about the Hezbollah, the Shiites in Lebanon, not only because of the importance of southern Lebanon to history of Shiism, but also because they thought that the relationship between Iran and Israel is going to become hostile one day. And in their thinking, and what I'm about to say is not my view, it's something that many of the guys who were involved in the planning of organization of Hezbollah have written about. Their thinking was that if we can have a formidable force in Lebanon right next to Israel, then we might be able to have to gain strategic depth against Israel. And in case Israel seeks to undermine us, we can undermine them there. So there were two reasons, emotional and religious, if you will, solidarity with Shiism. And again, I'm pretty sure most of the people in this audience do not know details of the history of Shiism, but if you really are interested, you need to know that southern Lebanon's role is that it was the place where, in the eyes of the 12 Shiites, where the Islamic world were persecuting and prosecuting the Shiites, many of the clerics went to southern Lebanon, and they sort of protected the faith. As a matter of fact, when in 1501, the young 14-year-old king of Persia, Shah Ismail Safavi, established Shiism in Iran. Iran at that time was predominantly Sunni. Iran was a predominantly Sunni country in 1501. So the young king decided to establish 12 Shiism, mostly because he wanted to distinguish the Persians from the Turks and the Arabs. But the problem was that there were not enough clerics in Iran who knew what Shiism was. So what did he do? He goes to southern Lebanon and brings a whole bunch of Shia clerics from there. And he brings them to Iran. And then in the course of the next 300 or 400 years, Shiism becomes the religion of the majority. So that was the significance for religious reason, but also for a strategic reason, the opposition to Israel. Now, why do I say it is the most trusted and the most important? Because A, Iran has invested more money in them than any other group, number one. Number two, it is the most cohesive, organized, disciplined, and ideologically disciplined organization that Iran has dealt with. Number three, it is very close to Israel. And number four, it is the place where Iranian influence throughout the Arab world can expand. Because after all, Hezbollahs are not Persians. They are Arabs who happen to be Shiites.
Right. Dr. Gordon, on the whole problem of the support for Hezbollah in terms of normalizing, even in the medium to long term, normalizing relations between Tehran and Washington?
No, it's a big problem. I'm glad you asked the question. I mean, I would first say I would stand by the statement that I didn't make, but that is to say the analysis that Iran sees Hezbollah as a primary tool and a core national interest in the region, I think, is accurate. I think they see it as a tool to maintain influence over Lebanon. I think they see it, obviously, as a tool vis-a-vis Israel, which they'd see as a mortal existential enemy in the region, thus its origins. And we also saw it as a critical tool in Syria. In 2013, when there was actually some question about whether the Assad regime would fall, it was a direct on-the-ground intervention by Hezbollah, sponsored by Iran, that was arguably a turning point and a major variable in propping the regime up. So not only do they see it as a critical tool, but it is. So I think the statement of analysis is accurate. That suggests that Iran does have an agenda of playing a role in the region and using whatever tools, including violence, to play that role. In other words, getting back to this Saudi perception about the Iranian threat or whatever you want to call it, you know, even paranoids have enemies. It turns out to be true that Iran wants to influence Lebanon and Syria and Israel and beyond. And so from the Saudi point of view, and Greg and I both alluded to this, you know, absolute insecurity and fear. Anywhere you go in the Gulf, you're the narrative of the four capitals that Iran controls, Baghdad, Beirut, Damascus, Sana'a. The notion is it'll be five or six soon if we're not. Exactly. Yeah. So there seems to be an element in truth of that, if we're right that Hezbollah is a tool for expanding this influence. And so that's why it is a problem. And it seems to me we've all talked in various ways about ending this Cold War, and some have put the emphasis on what the Saudis need to do, which is certainly true. They need to end their piece of the Cold War. But it turns out to also be true that Iran is fighting a Cold War, and this Cold War will go on. I mean, if Iran were willing to end its support for Hezbollah and not take a view on the future government in Bahrain, Lebanon, and Syria. I don't think the Saudis would have a problem with them, but it turns out they do. And so it's going to take two to tango.
Okay. A real quick question for Dr. Parker. Is Edridjian?
Yes.
Edridjian, the wisest man I know, by some margin, says that, in places like Syria, President Putin is playing a very bad hand very well. The departure, the announced departure of Russian forces from Syria that was made, what, 6 weeks ago?
Less. Yeah, March 14th.
Yeah. How genuine is it, and what do you think the motivations behind it were?
It wasn't really a withdrawal. It was a kind of a rebalancing of what they have there and a reframing of the whole political diplomatic context for it. But from the beginning, Putin made clear when he announced the beginning of the air campaign last September that it would be of limited duration and it would stick to the air. They've gotten a little bit of mud under boots, but not much. But in the back of most Russians, there are still bitter memories of Afghanistan, and it would be politically suicidal for Russia to go into Syria the way it did into Afghanistan. So that was never really in the cards. At the beginning, Putin said that they went in to fight ISIS. When he announced this partial withdrawal, afterwards he said, basically, we saved Assad, that's why we went in there. And that was really the reason they went in, because without Assad, there's no Russia, no Russian role in Syria.
Right.
So they have propped up Assad. I'm not sure that I would call the hand that they have in Syria a bad hand.
I mean, no, generally.
Yeah.
In terms of economic weakness.
Yeah. The statement I made is that Putin is playing a weak hand very skillfully in Syria.
Yeah.
Especially given the balance of power between the United States and Russia, I think he's playing a weak hand very skillfully in Syria. Yeah.
One thing a lot of people lose track of is that Putin really is a very smart guy. And in the Middle East, over the years that he's been in power, he was able, during his first round of re-engagement in the Middle East, to take advantage of U.S. use of overwhelming force. And this would have been in Iraq against Saddam Hussein. That scared, has been mentioned, the Saudis, et cetera, scared or discombobulated them, that we took out this balance against Iran that they thought was so valuable in the region. In more recent years, Putin has been very skillfully using the regional reaction to the U.S. using underwhelming force in the region, in the views of many regional capitals. You know, there was the August 2013 chemical weapons red line incident, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What was seen as a lack of reaction to Russia's doing the air campaign in Syria. So throughout the region, the perception that I have is that all of these capitals, even while they're still anchored security-wise to Washington, say Israel, Saudi Arabia, et cetera, they all want to have a relationship. They all want to develop a relationship with Putin, because this guy is a player. His economy may be stagnating, but he's willing to use force in a very measured way, very smart way, in their view. And he's going to continue to do that in Syria. Russia's position in Syria has really, it's gone from being on the verge of being pushed out back in 2011 That was the view you picked up in Moscow. You know, this was just the last gasps of the Russian, formerly Soviet, presence in the Middle East. Assad was going down. Summer of 2012, it really looked as though Assad was on his last legs. And Putin has stuck to a consistent course throughout. It started with Libya during the time that Putin was prime minister and Medvedev was president. And there was obviously some internal tension over Medvedev's decision to, I guess, abstain on the resolution that started the whole Libyan engagement going. Putin has often referred to the way Gaddafi was murdered, and basically he doesn't want that to happen to anybody else. Through thick and thin, he has said that although Russia at the beginning didn't have any material interests in Syria, it did have principles, and Russia was going to stick to principles that you can't do this without UN Security Council endorsement, blah, blah, blah. He stayed with that position. His constancy combined with what many see as U.S. vacillation and unwillingness to engage more heavily to contain what Russia was doing there has constituted what many see as a pretty skillful game.
Yeah. Now, Dr. Gauz, a real quick question. You know, we were both you and I believe Dr. Malani mentioned the Yemen, and I think almost all the panelists have. To what extent are developments in the Yemen being driven by the new power structure in Riyadh?
The new leadership in Riyadh is certainly more forward. The caution that had characterized Saudi policy in the past has been altered. But let's take this in perspective. The one place where the Saudis could intervene militarily and not face the Iranians or direct Iranian clients was Yemen.
Yeah.
I don't think that, despite some brave talk from some loud Saudis, I don't think we're going to see Saudi military intervention in Iraq or Syria anytime soon. I think Mohsen's point about the Houthis being, if you will, the least directly tied Iranian clients. Right? My soundbite on this has always been that the Houthis are more anxious to be Iran's client than Iran is anxious to be their patron.
Well put.
I think that the Saudis are less cautious, but they haven't lost all of their caution.
Okay. Now, look, I'm going to now accept a couple questions from the audience. And I guess the first hand up is this gentleman in the middle.
Before 1979, Israel was not the only country that had good relations with the Iran of the Shah. Why, after the revolution, the Iranians became so hostile to Israel?
I was about to relax from the question that Joe Hezbollah asked me. I demand to get paid twice as much.
Well, that ups the fee to $74.11.
Look, the definition of a revolution is fundamental change in the constitution of a government and in the personnel who take over, as well as their new ideology and a way of looking at the world. So in 1979, the Iranian revolution was based on a loose alliance among Iranian leftists, communists of all type, from the Trotskyites to the crazy Maoists to the Russian type, as well as Iranian nationalists, as well as Iranian Islamist nationalists, and then the supporters of Ayatollah Khomeini. Many of these guys believed they were product of the 1960s sort of liberation ideology, anti-imperialism, that kind of stuff. So when Ayatollah Khomeini took over, and immediately after the taking of the American hostages, when the Iranian policy changed, the hostility became more visible. Even during the Shah, when Shah had very good relationship with Israel, he wouldn't publicize it much. He would try to do it under the radar. The reason was because there was that animosity toward Israel, not toward the Jews, I believe, but toward policies of the state of Israel. And then right after the hostage crisis, because the U.S. and Iran became enemies, by extension, Iran and Israel became enemy. Having said all of that, I have to tell you, and I've said that before, the hostility that Iran shows toward state of Israel is not compatible with what I think is Iranian national interest. I think it is rooted in this Islamic ideology. Many of the leaders of the Islamic Republic, long before they became leaders of a revolution, had expressed their animosity toward the state of Israel and toward its policies. For example, Hashemi Rafsanjani, which happens to be one of the more moderate elements of the Iranian leadership, translated a book in the 1960s that was written by the Jordanian ambassador to Iran, which was very critical of the state of Israel. Ayatollah Khomeini was also very critical of the state of Israel. That was the ethos of that time. But to this day, I believe that state of Israel is not an enemy of Iran as a country. The relationship between the Jews and the Persians goes back to thousands of years. And I have done a little bit of research, and I can say that with certainty, and I'll be more than happy to get into detail, that if you look at the history of Iran, you'll see that the Jews were always respected there. I grew up in Iran until I was about 10 or 11 years old. I never, ever remember, and I was in high school, I was in school with a lot of Jews, I never remember ever looking at somebody and say, because you're a Jew, you have a different view. But I'm pretty sure there are others who don't share that view. But anti-Semitism as a systematic and evil way of denigrating and persecuting and prosecuting people based on their religion has never existed in Iran. Discrimination against Jews, yes. But the same kind of discrimination were rendered toward Christians, were rendered toward Zoroastrians, others. My hope is that one day that animosity comes to an end, because Iran is not a natural enemy of the state of Israel. And Israel, and again, please pay attention, I'm not using the word governments, I'm using the word countries. There is a difference between countries and states. When I hear some people in this country keep saying that Iran is a terrorist nation, that pisses me off. A nation is different. That is 101. He has been teaching classes in political science. A nation is very... I'm trying to be nice to you. A nation is very different than... I'm using the word a country, that Iran is not natural enemy of Israel, and Israel is not a natural enemy of Iran. And that means that anytime I want to go back to Iran, I'm going to be in deep trouble. And please don't ask me anymore.
Well, I went to the middle for one, so I've got to go over here to the right. 1 second. I guess the gentleman at the top, please. Yes.
Comments on Shia-Sunni conflict.
Yeah.
Is about Saudi fear of Iran. Ever since World War I, the old problems, the wars, everything has almost been initiated, and the Arabs have been betrayed by the Europeans over and over and over. And the Americans now are out there and actually destroying the whole Middle East and none of Europe.
But if you have a question, we'd appreciate a question, please. Yeah. Do you have a question, sir?
My question is, well, why would you say that there's a Sunni-Shia, conflict? Because really, I came with 37 students from Iran. And we were here in the United States in different universities, and nobody ever fought.
Well, no, I understand, but in fact, several of our panelists, I think two or three, have stressed the fact that it's important for us as Americans not to overemphasize the sectarian element, though it may well exist and might be important, and to realize that there are other factors and perhaps more important factors driving the current conflict in the Middle East. Now, there is, I guess, that gentleman there with the black shirt, because you've been putting your hand up so fast and so often. By the way, it better be a good question.
I have a question for Dr. Kulkarni, actually. So what is the prominent reason that Obama administration decided to start negotiations with Iran and not to continue the sanctions on Iran or make them tougher?
Yeah, I think I referred to that earlier. When President Obama came into office, Iran was already well advanced towards, clearly a nuclear program, but a potential nuclear weapons program. It had, by then, over 5,000 centrifuges, and over the course of the following several years, essentially mastered the fuel cycle from mining uranium to milling uranium to enriching it in centrifuges to enriching it further to a different stage of enrichment to potentially enriching it to highly enriched uranium, which is the fissile material needed for a bomb. In addition, it had begun construction of and significantly advanced construction of a heavy water power reactor that would be capable, with reprocessing, to produce weapons-grade plutonium. And it wasn't as if it went from one day to the next, from no nuclear program to being on the verge of a nuclear weapon, but over the course of a number of years, the previous decade and the early years of the Obama administration, it had really gotten to the point, and this has been publicly discussed now, that it was several months away from having enough fissile material to produce a nuclear weapon. So by the time the United States began these nuclear discussions with Iran, it was essentially time to fish or cut bait. By 2012, 2013, either you had to say, look, if we do nothing, if we don't resolve this diplomatically, then essentially we have two choices. We either let them carry on, finish the heavy water reactor, accumulate even more low-enriched uranium, 20% mm-hmm. enriched uranium, develop advanced centrifuges and research and development, and just say, okay, they are capable of making a nuclear weapon, acquiesce to it, which would have all sorts of consequences that I don't think we need to spell out here. Or you would have to eliminate it with a military strike, which would be effective in setting it back a certain amount of time, but in my own view, would also have the consequence of making the Iranians even more determined to develop a nuclear weapon, because you can't destroy the mastery of the fuel cycle and the knowledge or the uranium that's in the ground. And you'd have an even bigger problem on your hands. Iran would no doubt respond. We'd discuss Hezbollah. And in the region that we faced in 2013, 2014, is that what we really needed, is a direct military conflict between the United States and Iran that wouldn't even solve the problem for more than a couple of years? So I think that's the answer to your question. It was time to decide, acquiesce, use military force, or see if it was somehow possible to do a diplomatic arrangement that would not eliminate the problem, because you can't eliminate the problem. In that sense, any industrial country mm-hmm. is a degree of threshold state, because within a certain number of years, they could develop nuclear weapons. Damn. Now we have negotiated agreement that extends what is called the breakout time much more than a couple of months, or at least a year, for more than a decade. So it doesn't solve the problem, but I think I would certainly argue that it was far better than either of the other two alternatives that I mentioned of acquiescing or using military force.
I think we have time for one last question. Madam, in the middle.
Dr. Gauss, but we haven't gone into the economics related to the European Union and the European countries and what role they play in pressuring the administration, or perhaps to Mr. Gordon, on agreeing to this nuclear deal, because the fact that they felt they would very soon want to go into Iran economically, and the United States was being sort of held a bit hostage by that.
Phil, I'll let you take that one. Europeans, Europeans in your office pressuring you?
I'll take it, but if I do well, do I get a B plus? Do yeah. I,
you're out of the administration
now. I was
now.
Thinking of proposing. Yeah,
you're out of the administration.
So it can only be extra credit at this point.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Like an extra credit type.
Yeah, yeah.
I was
incomplete.
incomplete. Exactly. That's right. What was the question again? You're right to bring up the Europeans, and that was indeed an essential element of this, in the sense that, of course, to deal with the nuclear program and other aspects of Iran, the United States had unilateral sanctions on Iran for a long time. And those unilateral sanctions were not particularly effective, because in a world market, the U.S. is obviously a big market, but you're not going to really impact a country's economy if it's just you. It was only when we managed to get European support and Russian support and Chinese support and South Korean support in a difficult but critical diplomatic series of engagements that the sanctions became effective. The EU put an oil embargo on Iran, which would have been unheard of, 5 years before. We got the Russians, after it turned out the Iranians, for a second time had a secret enrichment facility. The Russians came on board, got Security Council resolution. So in that sense, the Europeans and our other international partners were critically important for getting the deal. They understood, they shared the goal of preventing Iran from getting a nuclear weapon, and that's why we had the world on our side, because Iran clearly had violated Security Council resolutions and was developing an illicit program. So just as it was critical that the Europeans and others were on board to put the sanctions on, we had to stay together. And I'm sure Wendy Sherman will talk about this in her speech this afternoon. That's why it wasn't an option for the United States, and I believe is not an option for the United States now, to go unilateral. As we debate the future of this deal and implementing it, and there are moves in Congress as we speak to take steps that would gut the deal, and we could walk away from the deal. But if we do that and we don't have our European international partners on our side, how effective is that going to be? And so the Europeans played a critical role. They stood by us throughout the process. But since the objective of the sanctions was to get Iran to give up its potential nuclear weapons program, we need to stick with that. And so long as Iran refrains from pursuing that program, then we need to uphold our end of the bargain. Okay.
Well, look, I would like to thank my panelists, and I would like to thank you in the audience for your attention and for your few but very good questions. We're now going to take a roughly 15-minute break and reconvene for the panel on internal developments.